We have the pleasure of, I'm going to tell you a little bit about this panel's, the next keynote, first of all. The next keynote, the group of alchemists, we're calling the keynote the alchemist, because somehow they didn't get on this one. It's called Vanishing in Plain Sight, and this is with Grace Williams and David Cheeseman. And it's a very political and evocative piece. If it gets started. And Grace Williams is a PhD student working on the supernatural and feminism and the role of the mediumship and so on. And her latest work was on ectoplasm, which was fabulous because it's completely mad and very interesting in terms of the absence presence. And in fact, the images of the posters, minus the one of the black cover with the two arms. So the other four images, these are all of Grace Williams' work. And the other one is David Cheeseman. David is an award-winning painter, sculptor, mainly sculptor, I think. He's done these incredible studies between land and building and size. And the one that's in his thesis, you can take a look at, it's about a huge globe where he's thought through how the different pieces fit together to form this magical piece of ash, actually. The main piece in the front foyer is David's, and he has been working absolutely nonstop, putting these little boxes together. And he's not done yet, so I suggested that he leave the map of the piece there so you can see it. But as the conference proceeds, it will hopefully be done. I'd also like to thank the artists who are all around, the actual artwork is on the walls and so on. As I mentioned at the outset, part of the difficulty about not having the names in our little program is that we didn't know where everyone was going to be, so we moved the map. We sort of moved everything around, and we should have a copy of this to hand out to you later today, I think. In fact, very soon, right now, actually. Hold on. Okay, so that was fast. Right, okay, now the panel that's going to come in after this is on transubstantiation. And the question that we're looking at, I mean, as you probably have now gathered, each keynote, each alchemist sets a kind of rhythm going so that the panel sort of runs off with it. And that's what's happening here. So this is a question of how one does a form of transubstantiation. And it's moving into these questions around how the body parts create certain poetics. So you'll see when you listen to Rachel Foley, her spurious plexus is a case in point on this. I don't want to get into the paper too much, it's very specific. And then Kit Polson, he's from the University of Western England, of West England, and I don't know where David is yet. Where's Kit? No, that's right. Thank you. The work that he was doing, everybody went through the process of getting into this conference by being peer reviewed. And that had to say the abstracts were sent out. They were then gone through by a working committee here, and then they were talking to other groups. This one was a standout one. We knew that we were going to be doing this right away, and we built part of the panel around, no pressure. That's how you get it. Around you, yeah, that's fine. And then, in fact, Holly said, there's a man named Kit Polson. Do you know him? And I was like, yes, we're actually pretty immense, so that's great. And obviously, Gregory will be doing another. Or did Gregory, were you doing your.
That was my lunchtime piece.
That was your lunchtime piece.
I did.
Well done.
The moment came. So, yeah.
And then, Annika French, who is a very brilliant MA student. <It's not like that. laughs> It's just me more than a Jew. Okay. Does he have no clothes?
He's
getting dressed. Okay, what else do we do? Songs. all right, I'll have a longer discussion. Would anybody like to ask some questions before we go on? Like the title of the conference or any of these kind of things? Anybody want to have, or how we came up with figuring out to have this conference? Anybody want to ask any questions about this?
Thank you, John.
Reflective. We came up with Twice Upon a Time because in the PhD seminars we were looking at the subjunctive, the use of the subjunctive, as not as a mood enhancer, but the way in which it had dissolved in everyday speech in the recent context. And we were also looking at this in relation to the fact that in German there is no Once Upon a Time. There's the, you don't say, you don't start a story that way, the sense of temporality. So we wanted to play around with this. We were talking about the elements and the way in which one talks about constellation. There's a lot of work on Adorno, Heidegger, which might sound odd, so we had them in the same group. And I think we were looking also at Lyotard and Leo Graeber's book, Groundless Grounds. So we were looking at these kind of in tandem. And it became clear that we wanted to talk about how the once that's upon a time is this sort of move, it's this moody move that sits upon this thing called time. But then you can play around with this because in the different languages it doesn't work like that. It doesn't sit like that. So we started talking about how time itself could play with itself. Okay, this is really not the outfit I thought you'd be wearing. How things are practice-led and how that creates a very specific sense of a rigorous intellectual commitment to knowledge. So that's how it all started. Now, without further ado, what you've all been waiting for, this is a song and a half, sorry, it's on the third, but anyway, is David Cheeseman and Bruce Williams. Thanks.
Self-acknowledged performance of undisclosed activity. So the question that kind of lies behind this kind of brief talk is, what were the conditions for this paradigm shift from passive spectatorship to an active intellectual engagement? It was only really the working with the body in the British tradition of illusion where the British audience became really fascinated by magic. And I'm just going to chart a brief history of that, paying particular attention to somebody called Guy Jarrett, who's massively important in the history of magic, It's in the top 100 celebrated most important people. But it's probably little known outside of magic circles. And he was very, very key in kind of development of the space for the body. So, just bring out this. Can everybody see me? But nobody sees me. Where's Johnny?
I'm here.
There's a USB plugged in somewhere.
There's a USB.
This clearly isn't working. So.
Oh, I see.
We shouldn't be seeing.
No.
Ah. Okay. Hold on one moment. Hold.
I'm joking. It's all right. And so this little image here that you see, that's a puppet that was made. It was actually a mechanical thing, a really, really divine kind of automata that did the most kind of miraculous things. And it's a combination of his own engineering in terms of the mechanics of it, and kind of sleight of hand and illusion in terms of how he made this puppet trapeze kind of into onto his lap, as it were, into his arms. The important thing about him in relationship to the space of the magical performance or the vanishing of the body is that he saw the theatrical art being a magician very much in terms of kind of being a gentleman and kind of working in the drawing room. So his setup was, as you can see here, were kind of the indications of a kind of early Victorian drawing room. Now this had resonances throughout the history of magic because today in Las Vegas we still see top hat and tails and working with doves and so forth. In relation to space it's important because he incorporated things like these screens and things like the kind of domestic furniture that you would see in the drawing room. And this became, I believe, the space for the vanishing. So it wasn't conceived of, it just became part of a kind of tradition that Houdin kind of created. This is an automata, and this was already mentioned in the first presentation. This is an interesting, a very interesting development in terms of the space for the body, because this predates Houdin's work, but it was a fake automata, and it was made by a Viennese physicist, and the body was actually concealed within the cabinet, and so it had all the accoutrements and all the kind of gubbins that made one feel that you were playing against a machine, but in fact you were playing against the body in this cabinet. And so this is an early example of how the body would be concealed and the kind of positions that the body would adopt. So this was this was early in the 1800s when this machine first kind of originated and was a fantastic. Was just a fantastic event because people really thought they were being beaten by a machine. And the space of this is actually equivalent, more or less, to the space that's in the piece I'm building in the concourse. That table is a gaming table and it approximates the kind of space behind the body, behind the gubbins for this automata. And the important thing about that was the relationship between for me, the relationship between the IBM program beating in the 1990s, first human in terms of artificial intelligence versus real intelligence. This was doing this kind of 200 years earlier, apparently. I begin really though with in terms of the space of a spectatorship, with the Davenport brothers, which have already been mentioned. They began as a spiritualist act, but they were found out, and as was mentioned earlier, they performed a certain kind of spiritualist performance by creating sounds and noises and various kinds of celestial kind of performances in a kind of darkened space in front of an audience. The problem is they were found out, and they went fleeing back to Buffalo in order to develop a different act. And this was kind of very well known, and Barnum, P.T. Barnum, wrote in The Humbug of the World about what happened. I'll just quote from him. The father of these boys, who had accompanied them to New York, took them home immediately after the exposure. In Buffalo, they hoped to retrieve their lost reputation by being not more honest, but more cautious, to secure greater immunity from detection and to enable them to exhibit in large halls, which could not be easily darkened. The boys finally fixed upon a cabinet. And this cabinet is, I think, is the kind of origin of most of the cabinets that we've seen in the history of kind of magic. And as you can see, it's a very big cabinet. But it enabled the duo to sit inside it, be tightly bound, and to throw things out of the cabinet, to make all kinds of noises, to create music. Apparently without any outside kind of interference. So they still suggested that there was some kind of supernatural activity, but they couldn't actually say that. And so they never, at this point at which the cabinet emerged, they never suggested that they were doing anything other than a kind of a magic act. In Liverpool, though, they were kind of found out and somebody bound them exceptionally harshly, and there was a riot, and the Liverpool audience didn't take to the kind of hoodwinking, and they got up on stage and they smashed out the cabinet. So it's kind of an interesting example of British, perhaps, not actually quite going to the kind of an American stage show, as it were. So this spurred a whole series of spirit cabinets by Thurston, by Keller. Each performing a very similar act, all within this big space of the cabinet. And it seemed that at the end of the 19th century, that people were more interested in something occurring in the darkness of a big space than they were thinking about how it might occur. So out of that who, what, where, when, and how of it, they weren't really interested in the how of it. Somehow they let themselves be immersed within a kind of spectatorship that was passive. And the bigger and the darker the space in which this transformation occurred, the better the transformation. And it was only in around about the 1920s when certain magicians started to challenge that. This is another example of what is essentially a Davenport box with a different kind of broken system. And here, the conjurer is clearly in a kind of cruciform kind of position. And there were variations on the these kind of cabinets. Here's a much smaller one by Keller. You can see the handkerchief is actually kind of taking the place of the body. And so they were trying to find different ways of kind of dealing with travelling shows by making smaller boxes, but they weren't expecting the body to necessarily appear in a box that big. This is a good example of the kind of look of the kind of cabinets. And when I talked about them being like the, kind of drawing room pieces, this is a good example of this very kind of strange cabinet where someone's being beheaded. And this is Melies, the filmmaker, an early example of him, one of the few examples of him being kind of photographed. That's obviously massively influential in the whole history of magic. Carter was another was another very important magician working in the 20s, his version of the spirit cabinet. And another one where we see this isn't a spirit cabinet, this is a different kind of vanishing, but again it's a very big box and it's using vertical lines to try and slim it down, but it's not really thinking about the space of the body and how you adapt that body to a space. And a final kind of version, this is actually where someone, the assistant is burnt and then appears in a box in the right hand side around this, again, very large curtained kind of area. this is an example of a kind of touring show, and an example of all the kind of massive kit that was used, and the nature of the volume of each of those spaces is clearly seen in relation to have no particular relationship to the body. They didn't seem to be concerned about the geometry of the body or the kind of unravelling of how something might have occurred. Now this is the first image of Guy Jarrett, who's this quite an amazing man from the particularly working in the 1920s. He produced most of the images for the best works for Pat Thurston. And what we see here is a bungalow kind of box. So this is Guy Jarrett, and he actually fits into this. So he was the magician's assistant, as well as the builder of the props. And he was made a point of telling the audience what he was going to do. So in fact, he let the audience know that he was going to be in that box, but of course they didn't believe that he was, because it seemed so kind of impossible. And this is part of the kind of staging of that bungalow kind of trip. And this would be Guy Jarrett sitting in the negative space on the sloping floor. He was, I think he was the magician's assistant or builder more than any other, that talked about 7 or 8 inch space. You only need 7 or 8 inches to conceal a body. And that would be the 7 or 8 inches there that he's working with. And so that principle was used in kind of all of his work. This is a text that Jarrett produced, which is actually about trying to tackle the depression, because this was occurring in the 1920s. And I bring it up because the text is full of figures. It's actually absolutely crammed with the imports, exports, gross domestic wealth, what people earn. And he was trying to unravel how you might unpick the American economy at that time. And so it's kind of an indication of the obsessive nature he had with figures and trying to kind of pin things down. It's also an early example of a self-publication. And that's just worth mentioning in relationship to magicians' craft generally, that so much of their work is self-published. There's a whole industry of kind of self-publishing. And in Jarrett's case, he actually set every bit of typeface. this is him, he's about 70 here, and the latter part of his life, he was interested in making gym equipment for kids. And this is him kind of playing with it. And an example of how he was interested in how the body might kind of be manipulated in space. This is, I think this is one of Jarrett's most important tricks. It's the 21-person cabinet. And this is just a drawing post-Jarrett by Steinmeier, the well-known kind of author of magic history. The space that you see here now is the space of the 21-person cabinet. And what's amazing about this magic trick is that there's no magic. There's no trapdoors, there's no reloads, there's no wires. All there is 21 people in this space. And it's about how the load was undertaken. The people came out 6 at a time. So the first 6 that entered through the device of the single baffle and the darkened space, you thought that the cabinet was empty. And then a further 6 came out. And then a further 6 came out. And then another 3. And it was the genius of Jarrett to kind of put people in the baffling, the ornate kind of baffling that went over the top of the cabinet, and they slid down the back. Now we've become used to the idea of cramming hundreds of people into minutes, but at the time this was kind of radical. And here we see the breakdown of that unit operating on kind of that 18-inch reel there, and the very kind of rudimentary nature of it as a kind of but beautiful kind of construction. Some more details. There are examples of other cabinets that were made by other people that weren't as effective. His attention to detail was really, really important. So, for example, at the bottom there in plate 43, you see the difference between an 8-inch and a 10-inch pedestal. The pedestal was often used for delivering people onto stage or out of the trapdoor. But you can see how hugely different the size of that 8-inch is to the 10-inch that kind of Jarrett is standing on. And this is an example of him working out how to make an elephant invisible, surrounded by a crowd. And this is an example of his obsessive nature in terms of making the car invisible. He actually built the car, which you could take apart. So everything was made of cardboard and paper mache and absurd attention to detail in terms of the building it. But it was never taken on show because it took 58 seconds, I think, to actually break down. Whereas the trick that was actually used is this kind of device where the white lines are actually slats of mirror. So when the mirror is twisted, the whole thing becomes like an atlas box, which means two mirrors meet and you lose the space, the object, kind of the inside. And another example of his kind of ingenuity was in relationship to the actual levitation of a person. here he's using a gooseneck device, which allows the magician to pull the loop through the body by the use of how it's articulated around the gooseneck. But this particular device was particularly successful. This is an example of a variation on the transformation of the body. And it's another example of the body being broken into three pieces. So this is a drum that spins around and divides the body into three, and then it comes back together with the female assistant in one. And this was a result of Selbit's box, which was first built in 1921, and caused a massive sensation. So it was the first example of a woman being cut in half. And you can see the size of the box is really considerable. And they paid no attention to how the movement of the body might occur within that. And this spurred variations on it. So for example, in this one, you see the head and the legs come out of the box. But again, it's still a huge volume, particularly with regard to the space beneath the actual box itself. And often you would see these kind of posters where we see the woman being cut in half, as if that's what's going to happen. But you never saw the woman in the box. The box was always kind of closed. And this is another example. Moving on, because of the success of the cutting up of the woman, variations on this occurred very quickly. So for example, based on the previous one, is. This is this woman gets crushed by the two other women. So there are balloons that are around her, and the top one kind of box is slammed through the lower box, and the woman is kind of crushed. But again, it's hardly anything genius in terms of how the bodies are disposed in space. And now a kind of piercing as another example. Moving on, and I'm concentrating on kind of tricks where the body is being divided into three pieces. There's a series of images here of that occurring. So the box has got smaller because of Jarrett's influence, and partly also because of the ending of kind of vaudeville. The theatres were lost to movie houses, and so the tricks could no longer be performed with big boxes because they went on touring shows. And there were lots of variations about smaller tricks and where the body was kind of more confined. This is probably the ultimate example of that, where there is no box at all. And in this particular case, and this is later, this is in the kind of 30s, 40s, where we see the body actually being cut in half, and and the legs and the body run away off out of the stage. And this was the guy that was in Freaks, the film Freaks. So he was a half man, as the film described, which allowed that to kind of happen. I just thought I'd introduce this kind of Orson Welles aspect to it. This is the kind of stage show in around Hollywood that he was very much involved with. And as you know, Orson Welles was a huge illusionist, and he really kind of developed the idea of the kind of overindulgence in the spectacle of it. So I think it's the only example of suggesting that we were going to actually see a woman sawn in half kind of vertically. I just thought this was a good example of how the kind of spectacle of it became more and more gross. And there's a kind of American saying in I think it's in journalism that if it bleeds, it leads. And so this very much became the kind of motto for the magicians at that time. This is an example of Houdini's work, and I'm just including it because game party was my piece upstairs, and this involves a carpet, and this is Houdini walking through a brick wall, and it's an example of this kind of 8-inch principle, where there's a carpet and then sackcloth, and the carpet allows the body being disposed through a trapdoor underneath the wall. Because of the looseness of the carpet, you don't actually see any movement, and it allows that kind of that device to occur. This is from Houdini's book on magic, so it's his particular drawing for that book. I thought I'd point to where we are in a kind of contemporary sense. This is a book of current speculative boxes for the reorganisation of principally the female assistant. David Madoso is one of the big kind of illusionists now, builders, is the kind of editor of this book. And this is a kind of variation on the boxing book, but very, very kind of complex reorganisation of the body, where you get little bits of hand which are appearing throughout the boxes. And there we can see how the body is disposed. And this is in space. And this is another example of a kind of self-published artist book. I want to finish with a very brief discussion about Robert Harvey, who's a British-based magician. I'm sure some of you know. He emerged in the 50s. And was very, very successful during the 60s. And he was a brilliant illusionist. He's an example of a magician that spent years just working out how to make things appear and disappear and the mechanics of it. And these are examples of his personal drawings in relation to the devices he used. And these are all from a book called Harbin. That's it. He spent 4 years developing a particular trick over which you're about to see, and he made 4 attempts at it. He worked very much like a kind of sculptor artist.
And, I remember when I was a little girl, our house.
Now we're going to perform it.
I'll never forget the look on my father's face as he gathered me up in his arms, raced to the burning building on the pavement, and I stood there, shivering in my pajamas and watched the whole world go up in flames. And when it was all over, I said to myself, is that all there is to a fire? Is that all there is? Is that all there is? Bring out the booze and have a
And he came up with a miraculous idea that these women could be shipped off to the colonies.
and that they would happily disappear with no problem at all. What he failed to actually anticipate is that it would take 10 years to move the amount of women, and the amount of babies that would be born in that 10 years would actually cancel out any effort that he would have made on that part. So he just took that on. So Karen Beckman takes this up in an argument that she had in her book Vanishing Women, and she states, Britain did not want its surplus women to disappear into the space of the colonies, but it longed for a disappearance that would have to deal with either the materiality of the body or the violence inherent in disappearance. So in short, Britain wanted a magical version of a female disappearance. So just a brief kind of overview of where magic has come from. Most people may be familiar with images of Indian fakirs. Now, the colonies obviously were only recently colonized by Britain. And so the orientalized image of magic came from India, and that was really carried through to most of the tricks that were designed at the time. So if you just look along this, yeah, this next image is by a magician called Bhotiskulta, an illusion maker, sorry, called Bhotiskulta, who is based in France. And this trick really came about as a response to W.R. Briggs' issues around, you know, what to do with all these surplus women. So you can see here that this is Mademoiselle Patrice, who was very nicely described as being a plump lady, sorry, for being quite a hefty lady. So she was supposed to be representative of the mass of women that were in society. And you can see that she's covered over with a piece of fabric. Now this fabric was often an oriental style piece of fabric, so it was heavily patterned. And this would be representative of obviously the colonies and of India and the origins of magic. And then on the floor you can see a sheet of newspaper. Now this is not normal newspaper, it's actually made of India rubber. So this was a new piece, a new material that had come out from India rubber and colonized. So this was kind of within the illusion itself, when she disappeared into the piece of newspaper, as you can see through the trap door, that she was actually, this mass of womanhood was disappearing into the colonies without even making a dent in the day's news. So it was a kind of political, a kind of projection of the anxiety that was happening in British society of what to do with these women, and obviously shipping them off to the colonies. Now, interestingly, I'll just say that the gentleman that we hired this magical illusion box from, Scott Penrose, who is a magician, I don't know if anybody recognises his name, he used to be on the Generation Game, which I find massively entertaining. he actually built this illusion, and he said that it's actually incorrect. Any drawing that exists of this illusion is actually wrong. The woman would not be able to vanish in this trick. She would actually be imprisoned, which I find quite interesting because it actually completely undermines Karen Beckman's arguments. So this is a good point for me. But yet, you can see the piece of wire that goes around the knees. If you can see just on the, I think it will be your left or your right. this would actually stop the woman from being able to disappear through the trap door at the bottom. So then just click on to the next slide. Now, you can see the oriental kind of trappings of that magical illusion and how that was obviously bred into the fact that it was coming from the colonies, and magic is very much rooted in Indian culture. So the superior British magician carefully separates the spectacular female body, whose well-being we actually care for, for the less visible traces of British colonised space, traces of which disappear along the notice with the lady but never come back. So this is actually a response to the fact that in the earlier trick that I showed you, which is Bhotiskulta, the piece of fabric that used to cover the body was eventually vanished with the female body, but was never brought back. So as we've heard in lots of other people's talks today, the whole point of an illusionary trick is to have the reveal again at the end that there's nothing wrong with the person. So that obviously happened in this trick still, but the oriental piece of material was lost forever. So I'm quite interested in the spaces that women vanish in. So we've obviously seen in this box, but also in David's 21-person cabinet, the idea of this disappearance within a certain set space. Now, as Johnny has mentioned, my PhD is actually on the supernatural and specifically, well, more specifically, mediumship. So I'm quite interested in the seance room as a space for disappearance and how that can actually change or alter the way that we think about these things. And once again, similarly in Martin's paper earlier, we saw the shackles that are often used in magical illusion tricks, but also with mediums and how they're attached to chairs. You can see here there's the kind of neck locks, ankle locks that would fix the medium in place. And it's always kind of tests of how the body can actually fit into these certain spaces and work. So just in the slight change to the topic. this is an image that's really been quite inspirational to some of my own artwork, which is very much based on this kind of theme. This is a medium Mary Marshall, who produced ectoplasm. That was her kind of trick, if you like. but you can see here that her face is covered in a piece of fabric. Now, this was actually supposed to be ectoplasm, and it was taken the form of what is called a supernormal scar. this is actually how it's referenced in the archive, a supernormal scar. So this really brought back to me the use of fabric and how that's really been quite relevant through magical illusions. So we've seen in all of these tricks the use of fabric is really, really important. And obviously pattern fabric makes things a lot easier because it has a flat surface, and the idea of folds and how it can create a different kind of illusory perspective. So if we just flip forward to the next one. People will probably be quite familiar with these images now because there's been a recent publication of them. But these are hidden mother photographs from the 19th century, and you can see that the idea was for the female body or the mother to actually disappear in the image and to hold the children still so that they could actually have a long exposure photograph. But in fact, it actually makes the body more visible. So I've actually used this as a motif in my work recently. So I'm using the Persian rug, which has obviously been present in motif Coulter's trick, but also in other illusions. As a kind of motif for magical vanishing, but also the ability to hide something, but also reveal something at the same time.
I remember when I was a little girl, our house caught on fire. I'll never forget the look on my father's face as he gathered me up in his arms and raced to the burning building on the pavement. I stood there, shivering in my pajamas, and watched the whole world go up in flames. And when it was all over, I said to myself, "Is that all there is to a fire? Is that all there is? Is that all there is?
Anyway,